Arcane is wild. There are a lot of words you can use to describe this show, but as soon as one adjective arrives, another one comes alongside it. And fewer still that feel like one concentrated adrenaline rush of colors, light, movement, and sound that boil down into one simple descriptor feels alive. On a minute-to-minute basis, Studio Fortiche stuffs the 9-episode run to the brim with sequences that feel as if its animators are flexing their technical capabilities. Moments packed with symbolism, others with a more intimate character exchange, and in other cases, just create some of the most energetic, dynamic, and utterly breathtaking animation this side of Spider-Verse. Suffice to say, everyone I've chatted to about this show has gone on at length about their favorite scene, or the moment when they knew it had their full attention. With answers ranging from this fight scene on the bridge, oh, this fight scene, dude, to a reunion gone horribly wrong.
Saw you hanging out with Caitlyn yesterday!
Rebecca, it's not what you did!
I won't hesitate, bitch!
Having just one answer is kind of difficult. There's actually so much you could talk about. That's why it was all the more surprising that the instance it actually hooked me wasn't any of the needle drops or the fights associated with them. Instead, it came from this small, seemingly unimportant decision that put into one single word is human. So the scene takes place about 10 minutes into episode 1. After getting a taste of the class division between two cities followed by some slick parkour on the rooftops, we see one of our main characters, Powder, raiding the office of one soon-to-be golden boy, Jace Talis. And then this happens. So in the grand scheme of things, this bit really isn't that important. It's mainly used more as a springboard to introduce us to the central plot MacGuffin. When placed right beside it, this mid-tier sandwich doesn't share the same level of plot significance, but that's why its inclusion feels considered. Like, what does this poor girl who hasn't seen much natural sunlight or food that wasn't scavenged from a gutter do first? That small expression of bliss speaks more than words ever could. There's a similar scene that takes place in episode 5, where Vi offers Caitlyn some of Zahn's finest cuisine, but this meat is a sore sight to an inexperienced resident of Piltover who probably hasn't had anything that doesn't come from a sanitary gourmet kitchen. It doesn't have that same glossy Instagram quality to it. The series doesn't really draw attention to this part of its worldbuilding in the same way it does to, say, the architecture or clothing of its different residents. Despite that, time was taken to show something as insubstantial as food can be a key part of a location's ecosystem. Arcane, at its core, is a show about division. Division between cities, division between siblings, a story about individuals whose core driving motivators have them clashing with and occasionally destroying other people in the process. There's a constant drive to push forward felt across many of its multi-layered characters, and in that march towards achieving this unattainable goal, there's another story going on. Not within the show itself, but instead the passion in every aspect of its production. From editing, character design, cinematography, to the razor-sharp visual storytelling, all these different elements combine together into something that, for a lack of a better word, feels alive. In order to get to that place, we need to start with the good book. Boruto, The Bad Beginning, Batman? B-Stars? Get that gay shit out of here, because today we're going to be talking about the Bible. Or at least the editor's equivalent, also known as In the Blink of an Eye.
A good editor must have some sense of how to tell a story. And that involves a sense of rhythm. And it's a little bit like telling a good joke. If the joke is... The joke could be a great joke, but if you tell it with the wrong rhythm, it falls flat.
This is Walter Murch. If you've never taken a film class before, you may not know the name, but definitely recognize the work, including but not limited to the likes of American Graffiti, Apocalypse Now, and a host of other classics. Murch is a legend in the field of film editing and sound design. His output has had an exponential effect on not just what we see, but hear as well. Like, take the landing sequence from the general episode of Star Wars The Clone Wars. As one of his only two directorial credits, the other one being Return to Oz, oh my god, the childhood trauma, here we come, he makes his presence felt immediately by removing the usually triumphant musical score we'd associate with Star Wars, and instead gives us this.
Oh,
He lets the battle for Umbara be punctuated not with music, but instead a symphony of explosions, lightsabers, and shouting that feels authentic, like you're stuck in the middle of it. It's why if you've ever had any interest in getting into editing, his 1992 book, In the Blink of an Eye, is essential reading. It's not focused on how to use any given software, but instead more focused on the mindset that goes into making your story come together effectively, which in his own words is by following the rule of six. What I'm suggesting is a list of priorities. If you have to give something up, don't ever give up emotion before story. Don't ever give up story before rhythm. Don't give up rhythm before eye trace. Don't give up eye trace before planetary. And don't give up planetary before spatial continuity. Emotion is what makes film work. Heck, it's what makes storytelling work. Visuals are some of the strongest ideas we latch onto as viewers, and when done effectively, it can transcend language barriers to become universal. Now, with that established, we're going to pivot slightly and talk about Studio Fortiche. Founded in 2009 by these three lads, the Parisian studio doesn't have quite the same reputation as some of the industry heavyweights like DreamWorks or Pixar, but by design their output is quite different. They weren't an early innovator in the field or had some stable financial support going into their company. They also weren't making feature films compared to those previous examples. Instead, much of their work was based primarily in commercials, doing ads for the likes of Sprite, along with music videos for Gorillaz. All of which was designed with this hybrid of both 2D and 3D animation, which gave their work a distinctive voice. When many companies would push more towards the latter's versatility and popularity, Fortiche looked at it and said,
Both is good.
While commercials do operate under a lot of the same techniques as traditional filmmaking, what separates the two is what is being portrayed. The approach for the former is less focused on delivering a narrative and is instead built on the product being sold. Because of the short window of time, they have to condense as much essential information for the viewer in an easily digestible manner. As much as people would mock Michael Bay's usual proclivities in his filmography, it's purpose-built for the specific visual language of commercials. I mean, he started his career with the American Red Cross in 1992, and 30 years later, he's basically doing the same thing but with longer runtimes, explosions, and drone shots. Because it's cool, why do you think so many games employ CG trailers to get people interested? It's why the trailer for Dead Island is more memorable than the actual game itself. This rule of cool is what led to Riot Games collaborating with Fortiche on multiple different projects. And then, in 2018, they made this. With over 500 million views, and about 6 of them being mine, Pop Stars is one of the best damn music videos of the last decade. It takes a lot to have someone like me, a simple culchie from Northern Ireland who has no interest in League and K-pop, which I have a little appreciation for, pulled out a polymerization card, merged them together, and created something I might actually like.
Wow, that is delicious. Finally, some good fucking food.
There's so much to love about the animation that every rewatch allows you to pick up some new detail. Like how every shot is consistently pulling back, which makes each subsequent edit feel organic, to the way the virtual camera employs this anamorphic lens to have each member stand out from the background, or how the depth of field brought on by the framing makes the VFX work pop. Star. Like, dude, when the smoke parts and Soyeon's rap vocals come smashing in, ugh, goosebumps every single time. It's cool, chaotic, and infinitely rewatchable. It's important to have this context in mind because it can be easy to view Arcane in isolation as just a really good show that came out on Netflix, but when taken as part of the studio's collective output, it becomes the culmination of all their work so far. It's every mistake learned and every technical advancement made over a decade of practice. This drive to achieve the best work possible isn't just one department doing the heavy lifting, instead it's how every part of Arcane's production is finely tuned to make it the best it can be. I've been beating on this drum for long enough now, so let's actually talk about the show. Despite what the Oscars might tell you, editing is really important. It's not just about cutting, it's how the rhythm and method behind the cuts can alter how a scene's constructed, but also how it's interpreted. Good editing can elevate a mediocre film into something more enjoyable, Or in the case of Taken Free, oh my god, I think I've just developed epilepsy. That cutting was so rampant. Putting it simply, Arcane is a blast to watch. All of its commercial sensibilities carries across to its cinematography and editing. At times, it feels as if it were an extended music video with the way the sound design and compositions are framed. See, in traditional animation, cuts are usually motivated more out of a sense of efficiency rather than emotion. Because a lot of shows use storyboards to plan out individual shots, it makes sense to give something of a rough sketch for animators to work off. Watching this animatic for the Owl House, you can slowly see all the different departments coming together into the final Grom sequence. And it should be noted that I am not dissing storyboard artists here, as it is an essential part of the process. But let me show you a storyboard from Arcane. Look at all this detail put into the facial expressions, the framing, the mood and tone. This goes well beyond just a simple sketch because, well, the team didn't approach it like a simple sketch. And this is shared across many different departments because the team approached it more like a feature film, allowing the editors and screenwriters to add their own touches to make the show better rather than hitting a deadline. The only other show I can think of with a similar approach would probably be The Clone Wars. As an animated show that pulls more from live action to influence its production, even the use of matte paintings for backgrounds gives their respective worlds a real tactile feel. They look built by hand and lived in for 20 years. They feel like places you could visit. Usually concept art needs to be dumbed down to fit in with the established art style, but looking at the end product, the transition is almost seamless. When the last drop is run by Vander, it's crowded and worn down, but it has a warmth that makes it feel like home. Much like its leader who's one with his people, who's gonna stick up for the little guy. Vander, what a lad. But when Silco overtakes that position, the colors change with it, replaced by harsh flashing neon and his office separated from the patrons, like he took his lonely aquarium with him. His regal clothes forever showing his separation from the people of the Undercity. He's a leader who's not with his people, he's someone who sees himself as above them. Silco, what a bastard! That's like the worst thing he does. You know, outside the drug stuff, but still. So he seems completely heartless, but all this is then subverted by the many colorful objects around his desk, suggesting that there's another side to his behavior, a split if you will, which is visible through the scars showing his face in two distinct halves. That's not just cool filmmaking that's nice to look at but offers nothing substantial. That would just be eye candy. It would be more like eye protein, something that is visually pleasing yet also technically complex and most importantly tells a story. But since I'm not as cultured, just like Shrek, it has layers. The camera work goes beyond looking cool. The attention to blocking and compositional techniques shows us the conscious decisions which inform individual characters' personalities. Film burn and broken glass is used exclusively for Powder's increasingly worse mental state. Jason Victor's experiments employ these experimental, almost overwhelming explosions of flashing light and movement. Or when it comes to scenes with Caitlyn and Vi, the camera does the complete opposite and stays still, letting each shot hold for longer, even using a bokeh macro lens to let these POV shots really let us feel the intimacy of this moment. It's a rare example of the show just staying still and letting the viewer and the characters breathe, and that's important because it's truly deserved. From the first instance we met her on that worn-torn bridge, Vias had to be nothing but strong, to be a strong leader, a strong older sister, a strong person to survive in the prison she was thrown into at 15, and the last person she was ever vulnerable with was her father figure Vander, which didn't exactly go well. So the last person she'd want to associate with is an enforcer like Caitlyn who's never had to deal with the same kind of emotional baggage. But at the same time, what Caitlyn offers is something that's not immediately apparent. That both sides have more in common than they'd like to think, and it takes one difficult step forward to mend that damage. Each scene that follows can be seen as the two taking a step closer to understanding each other, starting out as antagonistic to teasing to slowly warming up to each other acts as a natural link in the chain of their character arcs. Like, you could make the argument of when Vi finally trusts Caitlyn, but to me, it happens in this shot here. It's in that look where the bridge finally connects. Not just a union that could fix this divide, but could maybe be something more.
They seem to be very good friends.
Since we're on the subject of looks, it's probably worth taking a bit of time to talk about character design. As a quick aside, this isn't my field of expertise, but I do have this friend, represented here by Donald Duck, who's a bit more knowledgeable than I am. They also like Kingdom Hearts and Detroit Become Human, so their tolerance levels for bullshit is much higher than mine. It's because of this I'm going to hurt their feelings even more by pushing myself into looking at Final Fantasy XV.
Holy God, what are you showing me? Come on.
In isolation, Nomura's art is good, stylish, even beautiful. There's a reason why it's so popular in cosplay. You'd be hard-pressed to go to a local con and not see Buster Swords and big-ass shoes. But my problem comes from taking this piece of visual data and placing it into an environment which doesn't complement it. The world feels like a tech demo made separately from the central character designs. Contrast is important, but this doesn't feel deliberate, which means they just feel like video game characters or cosplayers who got lost on their way to QCon, ending up in a center on the other side of the Holy Lands. You see these Fallout boys in a shop, you're gonna feel a disconnect. Like all parts of visual design, a character's appearance should be something that logically connects with the world around it and complements the narrative, especially one that takes place over an extended period of time. Seeing characters grow older and gathering the scars that life deals them could be an extremely efficient means of storytelling. Take Powder for example. In her younger design, the clothing doesn't really match. She has this striped shirt which is at odds with her jacket, just like the glove on one hand doesn't complement the brazier on the other. Coupled with a messy bob of blue hair, she sticks out like a sore thumb in the upper class Art Deco building to Piltover, but fits right in with an Art Nouveau mess like Zaun. Just like her thrown together outfit, it's simple yet functional. Now as the character designers wind the clock forward a few years, coupled with a little side of emotional trauma, we get...
That's me!
While the primary colors of blue and pink are still present, it's clear she's still carrying those scars with her. Now boasting these long, unkept ponytails, along with a black tank top and a big X in the center, there's nothing particularly glamorized about this older look. In fact, coupled with the tattoos, combat boots, and the bags under her bright blue eyes, she looks especially worn down. Which only gets taken to its logical extreme when after getting injected with Shimmer, that last tie to her innocence is lost, replaced with pale skin and dark pink eyes. Even just producing tears doesn't look natural anymore. It's a testament to the animators that they can make Jinx bounce from a threatening force of nature back to the lonely girl who just wanted to help in a matter of seconds. Really, what we see from the characters is through their eyes. It's the keys to their souls and outlooks on the world. There's looks of anger, resentment, and hope that the next generation won't make the same mistake as the one before it. All of the younger cast are going to carry that burden with them into this uncertain future. Mel, Jace, Echo, Caitlyn, and so many others have this desire to get better, to go beyond the status quo, and it's felt across everyone. It's no mistake that Vi and Jinx are given the weapons of their respective father figures, tools that were once built to cause harm to the other side, but now in the hands of another person can be something more. Or maybe the warning signs were never to be listened to, and just lead to another cycle of violence. After all, Powder died for it, and Jinx kills for it. It's the job of this younger group to fix what was broken, but that doesn't mean there wasn't a good foundation to begin with. In their final moments, both Vander and Silco stop indulging in the apathetic violence and comfort their daughters. As a crazy man once said,
You see, in their last moments, people show you who they really are. So, in a way, I knew your friends better than you ever did.
No, I'm sorry.
I never would have given you to them. Not for anything. Don't cry. You're perfect.
Silco, what a lad. Nothing is as simple as it looks. Rather, everything is a shade of gray. Like every living person, it's this mixture of conflicting beliefs and desires which make us go through the world to find our own place within it. There's something so utterly human about all this. Despite the steampunk setting and out there aesthetics, this is why Arcane works as well as it does, because it's not a show that succeeds in just one area, but collectively comes together to create something better. I'm a big believer that visual storytelling is the best and most powerful form of communication out there because through every pen stroke, editing choice, character design, and narrative decision, it's a truly one-of-a-kind show brought to life by a team that recognizes that individuality, that purpose, and more than anything else out there, truly feels alive.
It's okay. I'll show them. We will show more.